printed largely in your bulletin this morning. We have a mostly spoken service this morning. It's based on Divine Service Setting 5, page 213 in your hymnals. Please rise for confession and absolution. Beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
I said I'll confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquities of my sins.
Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent to them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being.
Upon this your confession, I by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant to the Word announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Precious in the sight of the Lord
is the death of the saints.
I love the Lord because he has heard
my voice and my pleas for mercy.
Because he inclined his ear to me,
therefore I will call on him as long as I live.
The snares of death encompass me, the pangs of Sheol lay hold on me.
I suffer distress and anguish.
Then I call on the name of the Lord.
O Lord, I pray, deliver my soul.
For you have delivered my soul from death,
my eyes from tears, my feet from stumbling. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Precious is the sight of the Lord,
is the death of his saints.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Almighty God, by your great goodness, mercifully look upon your people, that we may be governed and preserved evermore in body and soul. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Old Testament reading today is recorded in Ezekiel 37th chapter, beginning at the first verse. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out in the spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the middle of the valley. It was full of bones, and he led me around among them. And behold, there were many, very many on the surface of the valley. And behold, said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, an exceedingly great army. Then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Behold, they say, our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are clean cut off. Therefore, prophesy, and say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, I will open your graves and raise you from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you into the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and raise you from your graves, O my people, and I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live. And I will place you in your own land. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. I have spoken, and I will do it, declares the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
O come, let us fix our eyes on Jesus,
the founder and perfecter of our faith,
who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame,
and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God.
The epistle for today is recorded in Romans chapter 8, beginning at the first verse. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. By sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh into sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if in fact the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I am the resurrection and the life.
Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 11th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and his sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent to him, saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, this illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you, and you are going there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours
said to him, Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will recover. Now Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought that he meant taking rest and sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus has died, and for your sake I am glad that I was not there, so that you may believe. Well, let us go. So Thomas called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, let us also go, that we may die with him. Now when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world. When she had said this, she went and called her sister Mary, saying in private, the teacher is here and is calling for you. When she heard it, she arose quickly and went. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still in the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary rise quickly and go out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to weep there. Now when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come with her also weeping. He was deeply moved, and his spirit was greatly troubled. And he said, where's your lady? They said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. So the Jews said, see how he loved him. But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man also have kept this man from dying? Then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, Lord, by this time there will be an odor, for he has been dead 4 days. Jesus said to her, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me. But I said this on account of the people standing around, that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said these things, he cried out in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out! Face wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what he did, believed in him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
Sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
live stream. We are greatly indebted to Scott Bowles and John Alvarez, who so quickly moved on this and got this up and running in what is record time in the Lutheran Church, surely. We also want to thank the Lutheran Church Extension Fund, who is making a gift to us of a new live stream camera, which will be coming hopefully sometime this week, so that by next week I'm hoping that we'll be able to have that up, and it should greatly improve the quality of the live stream. You can't do much with the pastor, but the live stream will be better. So some of you at home during this week have expressed to me concerns that you're having over missing worship during this time. And I just want to take the opportunity to remind you several things. First of all, remember that everyone has different needs and different circumstances, and everyone is making the best decisions they can right now with caring for their physical health and caring for their spiritual health, both. None of us have ever done this before. We don't have a crystal ball to determine what's going to happen in the future. What you absolutely must have is God's Word. That is all that is absolutely necessary. And then, of course, you also have, on top of that, the power of your baptism, which is with you every moment of every day. So many of you, particularly those of you who are home, of course, have been concerned because you're having to fast for a time from receiving the Lord's Supper. And I want you to know that you do not need to be concerned about that. The Lord's Supper is an amazing additional gift for us, but it is an additional gift. It receives all of its power from the Word, and you have the Word already. I thank all of you throughout the congregation who remain steadfast and hopeful, lifting everyone's faith up with your faith. And I encourage everyone in the congregation, both here and at home, to refrain from arguing and criticizing and judging other people for their various choices, particularly on social media. Please remember that social media is a place for positive, uplifting things, not for negative and snarky things. Remember that all of us are filled with Christ. And so this is our opportunity as the children of God to spread hope instead of fear. It's our opportunity to spread love instead of divisiveness. It's our opportunity to spread joy instead of guilt or grief. There may be no greater opportunity for any of us in our entire lifetime to share God's love with the people around us in the world, to give people who are filled right now with fear and anxiety, to help them know that they are in the palm of God's hand and no one must worry or fear of anything. Please remember also, especially those of you watching from home, that I remain on duty 24/7 during this crisis. Never hesitate to call me night or day. The ringer on my cell phone is on, and I'm happy to help you in any way that I can. Moving on to the sermon. Have you noticed? I know I have. God rarely works in the way we think he should, or in the time that we think he should. He rarely follows our plan. And we know that worry is a huge waste of time and energy. And yet, we find ourselves worrying anyway. Why is that? If you're a child of God, you know that God turns all things for our good. But yet we worry. And we worry because while we know that God turns all things for our good, we're not so sure that God's going to think what is good, what we think is good. We want God to do it our way, in our time. Worry is a sin. All worry of any kind is a violation of the first commandment. You shall have no other gods. And when we worry, we're putting what we want before God. We are demonstrating our belief that someone or something is more powerful than God. Worry, I think, may be our biggest idol in this life. And every time we make sacrifices to that idol with energy or time, worry, we're breaking the first commandment. Now, I know people try to justify worry. I do too. People like to justify making sacrifices to any of their idols. Oh, I'm not worried. I'm just concerned. No. Concern is when you try to figure out what you can do to serve God and serve others. Concern is when you study the scriptures to try to determine God's will for you. Real concern is when we strive to know God's will in the face of hardship, in the face of challenge, in the face of crisis. We know that God will see to it that everything will work for our good when we're following His will. And concern drives us to see that will as revealed in Holy Scriptures. We just don't always like that will. And so we try to impose our desires upon Him. The story of Lazarus is a classic example of people failing to seek God's will and instead trying to demand that God act according to their will. Jesus and the disciples get word that Lazarus is ill. Does Jesus rush out the door and hurry to the side of his friend? No. He hangs out, waits around for a couple days till Lazarus is good and dead. Then he goes. You can imagine the frustrations of the disciples. First, he took his time when he heard that Lazarus is ill. And then he announced that Lazarus was dead. And now they're going to Bethany, which is where the Jews were just recently trying to stone them to death, by the way. So what was the point of all that, Jesus? And Jesus tells them. He waited for Lazarus to die so that they and all others could see that death has no mastery over Jesus. They were all focused on saving Lazarus' life. That was of no concern to Jesus. Jesus knows that he has all mastery over death. And that all of these people need to see that God has everything under control. And honestly, he doesn't need our help. Serve him by worshiping him. Seeking to serve others. Showing his love, his mercy, his justice to the world around. That's what he wants from us. Last week we saw that Jesus could reverse blindness. This week we see that he even reverses death. But he does what he does when and where it pleases him, not when it's convenient for us. And not when we organize enough people on our prayer chain to ask him for it. And that's not to say that Jesus is capricious. He isn't some kind of whimsical God playing chess with our lives. But he's also unmoved by our demands for him to hurry up, fix it our way. One thing most Christians have seen in their lives, if they've been Christian for any period of time, is that our faith grows best under pressure. Now, none of us like pressure. It's uncomfortable facing situations in which we cannot clearly see the outcome. But like pressure is necessary to turn a lump of coal into a diamond, so is it necessary for faith to truly flourish. Our job is to feed our faith with word and sacrifice while we endure the pressure, knowing that
reversing blindness, and even reversing death. That's why we are continuing to worship in the midst of the COVID-19 crisis. I believe that word and sacrament are the most essential services we have. See, I don't care if I run out of toilet paper. I have plenty of recycling stockpiled in the garage. Toilet paper is not an issue for me. But we cannot simply shut down the supply of God's word and sacraments to his people. Different pastors make different decisions, and I judge no one because none of us were trained for this in seminary. There's nothing in the practical textbooks about dealing with a pandemic. But I have to be true to what I believe. And I believe that the proclamation of the word of God is absolutely essential in every circumstance. And that his holy body and blood are the medicine of immortality that will overcome all the things of this world. For those who need to remain at home, we offer the live streaming so that they can tap into the word of God. And for those who desire the gift of the sacrament, I remain here to offer it. See, Jesus shows us through Lazarus that pestilence and terror and even death have no power over us. That's why we have no fear of our most pernicious enemy, death. At its best, death is our friend and takes us out of painful situations in the world. At its worst, death is really no more than an inconvenience. We didn't get to accomplish what we wanted to accomplish. We didn't get to see something we wanted to see. But think about that for a minute. What in this world could you accomplish that is better than the throne room of heaven? What on earth do you want to see that is more beautiful than Jesus Christ sitting on his throne in paradise? Who are you going to mourn when they are enjoying eternal life with everyone we love in heaven? See, really, when you boil it down, our worries are silly and faithless and really kind of nonsense. And I know we all fall prey to them. But that's why we come to his word week after week after week, either in person or on our electronics. It's why we come to feast on his word and to remind ourselves once again that he has it all under control. That we are really just along for the ride, serving him. It is hard, really hard, for us limited creatures to walk with Jesus. It was hard for the disciples. And it continues to be hard for us. Because Satan is always whispering in our ears. Always whispering doubts. Trying to get us to believe that death is final. That life is dangerous. That it's all on us. Folks, there is nothing in this world that is better than what we have right now. That's why our song is Love Unknown. Who are we that for our sake our Lord should take frail flesh and die? It's truly ridiculous, but it's true. And if you ever find yourself doubting any of this, remember these words. Lazarus, come out! So too will every single one of us. great all transgressors, and those who are blinded and bound in the devil's kingdom, to know Jesus Christ, your Son, by faith, that the number of Christians may be increased. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Strengthen us by your Spirit according to your will, both in life and in death, in the midst of both good and evil things, that all of our own wills may be crucified daily and sacrificed to your good and gracious will. Into your merciful hands, Lord, we commend all who are gathered at home this morning, worshiping with us remotely. We pray that you would strengthen their faith through this mighty word, and keep everyone safe, healthy, and in good spirits until we are able to join together again. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray, Lord, for our homebound members, that you would be with them, especially during this time when they are not able to receive visitors, that you would comfort them with your presence. Elizabeth, Lavera, Eileen, Shirley, Bill, Charlotte, Sylvia, Otto, Georgiana, Doris. We pray for strength and for patience for all their caregivers. We pray also, Lord, for those who are in need of healing of any kind. Nicole, Anders, Nicole, Marty, Lori, Linda, Jan, Carrie, Jamie, Eric, Libera, Lisa, Rick, Joanne, Beverly, and Helen. We commend to you, Lord, all the people throughout the world who are suffering from COVID-19. We pray for your presence and your healing. And we pray also, Lord, that you would silence fearmongers who thrive on sensationalism. Continue to remind us daily that we are in the palm of your hand. We commend to you, Lord, the Pavlovsky family and the death of Tony's sister Cindy, praying that you would comfort them with the sure and certain promise of the resurrection of the dead. We pray, Lord, for the church, for Nick, our seminarian, for Jonathan and Cheryl, our missionaries, for Matthew and Jameson, our bishops, for the Asian Indian Ministry in Chicago, and for more in the world we sponsor in Indonesia. We pray, Lord, for our Commander-in-Chief and our President Donald, that you would give him strength and wisdom during this crisis. Help him to make decisions for us that please you. And we pray, Lord, for those who serve in the armed forces, Adam, Matt, Corey, Josh, Neil, Paul, Quentin, Brian, Lauren. We pray for those who celebrate birthdays, Adam, Sheila, Peter, Greg, Deborah, Aiden, Reese, Carson. And those who celebrate anniversaries of marriage, especially Norm and Bonnie, and Dan and Marcy. We commend to you, Lord, all who are in need, especially those of whom we're unaware. Pray for them at all times. Thy will be done. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant us our daily bread. Preserve us from greed and selfish cares. And help us to trust in you to provide for all of our needs. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Forgive us our sins, and we also forgive those who sin against us, so that our hearts may be at peace, and that we may rejoice in good conscience before you, and that no sin may ever frighten or alarm us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lead us, Lord, not into temptation, but help us by your Spirit to subdue our flesh, to turn from the world and its ways, and to overcome the devil with all his wiles. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
All Heavenly Father, deliver us from all evil, of both body and soul, now and forever. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We trust, O Lord, in your great mercy to hear us and to answer us, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, our God, King of all creation. For you have had mercy on us, and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Grant us your Spirit, gracious Father, that we may give heed to the testament of your Son in true faith. And above all, firmly take to heart the words which Christ gives to us, his body and blood for our forgiveness. By your grace, lead us to remember and to give thanks for the boundless love which he manifested to us, when by pouring out his precious blood, he saved us from your righteous wrath and from sin, death, and hell. Grant that we may receive the bread and the wine that is his body and blood as a gift, guarantee, and pledge of his salvation. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glories. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, take away the sin.
body and blood of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you steadfast in the one true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. Amen. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same, in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Website as well, so you can get the service both on the website and the Facebook page later on.